is Jesus. We've spent 7 weeks getting to Jesus being about 12 years old. We spent 7 weeks. We spent 6 weeks of getting Jesus from the birth narrative to being 12 to 18 months old. Then last week he was 12. And this week we find Jesus somewhere around 29, 30. The point being that there are some missing gaps in our biblical narrative of who is Jesus. For some, that is confusing. It is frustrating. I know it, because it adds to the mystery of the gospel. It allows you to grow a theologically sound and biblically based imagination. To think through for yourself, what would Jesus have been doing from this age to this age, from this stage to this stage? And yes, as much historical information as we have, it leads us to really ponder who. We've said at the beginning of the series that there are two things that we really want to wrestle with. One, we want to wrestle with the fact that many of us spend so much time looking at Jesus as being fully divine that we forget that Jesus was fully human. And so in our attempt to recover the humanity of Jesus, we want to see been missing as we explore the one who has invited us into the Christian church. And then two, as we learn more about Jesus, not only do we learn more about ourselves, but we learn more about the we, the church, the community, the us. And there may be some things that we learn about Jesus and thus ourselves and each other that may change the very nature of how we do what we do. That we are bold and courageous enough to disrupt our normative patterns so that we individually and collectively can be more like Jesus. So that means that all of us have to pay careful attention, and that all of us have to do our own introspection and reflection. And so today we gather after service for our conversations at COLCF, which we do every third Sunday. Perhaps we can process together what are some of the things that we realize about Jesus that can challenge us to do better and to be better. What are some of the things, I want you to think about this, and we'll conversate about this, that we are learning about Jesus that will help us to do better and help us to be better? What are some of the things that we're learning about Jesus that can help us to do better and to be here? Our scripture today is from the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 1, verses 9 to 13. If you have your Bibles with you, please feel free to read with me. If you don't worry, I will read it for you and with you and to you. You will all move forward together. Mark 1, 9 to 13. The gospel writer writes it this way. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in Jordan. And when he came up out of the water, immediately he saw the heavens opening and the Spirit. out into the wilderness. And he was in the wilderness 40 days, being tempted by Satan. And he was with the wild animals. And the angels were ministering to him. We often love this passage because it's one of the passages in the New Testament where God speaks. And I think more appropriately, if I had a really high-pitched, robust, warm voice, I think God probably sounds more like that than how we figure that God has this really deep baritone, real masculine, manly voice. Because this voice that we hear here is more of a nurturing, passionate, compassionate voice. It's almost a voice that you would hear when somebody has ushered in someone who was really anxious and frustrated, someone who was scared and really going through, and there's a hug and embrace. And then there's almost like a hand on the top of a head and says, "You are my beloved son. With you, I'm well pleased." Versus this kind of emperor type, robust baritone on the battlefield, looking over a half corpse, sending someone over to the next world and saying, "You're my son. And you are me." Our imaginations can take us in multiple directions. And one of the things I love about the gospel, the mystery of the gospel, is it allows us to have space for our imaginations. I pray that no matter how this passage is preached, that you allow your imagination to operate in real time so that you can see the narrative the way that you need to see it. So that you can feel the presence of God the way that you can feel the presence of God. What is clear is that Jesus has traveled from where he was to where John the Baptist is, out in the woods, on the banks of the Jordan River, the chilly Jordan River, baptizing people. John the Baptist was Jewish. In the tradition of the Jews, there was a sense of rebirth and purification and cleansing. The baptism of light was a part of that tradition, but John baptized differently. Jewish priests did. There was a practice of Tevila, which was an annual purification rite. John baptized, so it said you only had to be baptized once in your lifetime. So he moved from this kind of routine purification to this acceptance of understanding that God was calling you out. Out from the wages of sin into life everlasting. And that the transitional practice or process was the act of baptism. The act of baptism meant that you wanted to follow God in totality, that you were giving your whole body to be purified, to be cleansed, to be rejuvenated, to be revived, so that you could live for God. It was a rebirth. In the Southern Church, they talk about baptizing you in the liquid grave. It's the death of you living in a carnal sense. And the birth of you living in the spiritual and divine sense. So that baptism becomes a very important marker of a transformation in one's life. Certain practices, denominations operate with what we call child baptism. So the child is baptized, oftentimes when the child is given their name. But then there are other practices where children are Christian, they are dedicated to Christ, and given an opportunity when they come of their own decision, their own volition, to accept Christ as their personal Savior, to come before We don't hear of God having baptized God's Son. So baptism is for human beings. So there's a point in Jesus' life as a human where Jesus decides that it is time to live according to God's call from Jesus' mind, even though Jesus is God incarnate. Y'all gotta roll with me. We know that Jesus is God incarnate. God come in human presence to walk among us, to live among us, to teach us how to be human and how to be humane. And in that life cycle, even Jesus himself decides that it's important to purify his human body to regenerate his understanding that he is being transformed, even in the midst of him already being divine. Jesus does not use his divinity as an excuse. He uses it as a source of power to understand that as he's leading human beings to learn how to be human and how to be humane, he has to show us and teach us. And so Jesus shows us and teaches us by getting baptized. Jesus finds his dear cousin, John the Baptist, out in the wilderness. He travels from Nazareth, from Galilee, to the Jordan River, and he allows John the Baptist to baptize him. Now, I'm not going to get into the great debates of whether it was full immersion or half immersion, whether the water was sprinkled on his head 3 times or whatnot. We're not going to get into those debates. Those debates didn't split churches. The point is that there was water. There was a willing entity, a person, and somebody baptized him in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. As Jesus was being baptized, the Bible says that the sky opened up, the heavens opened up, and like a dove gliding down, the Holy Spirit fell upon Jesus. At the beginning of Jesus' ministry, he is tempted by Satan for 40 days. Some of you feel tempted by Satan for 40 years. Perhaps 40 weeks. The point that I'm making is that before the temptation, God already prepared. Before he went out into the wilderness, God already sat with him and said, I am with you. I am already pleased with you. God affirmed him before the temptation. Think about your life. In those moments when God sits with you and said, I'm with you, hold on to your seat and buckle your belt because you're headed into a moment of transition. God prepares you for everything that you will face if you realize that it's God preparing you for what you're about to face. It's coming. It's a part of the reality of life that we must go through. The Bible says that he was in the wilderness for 40 days with the wild.
Your space, in your home, you may have some wild animals.
you the way the angels will minister to you. So you got to be careful what you're looking for. It may come in a different shape or a different size. It may come in a different voice, in a different situation. It may come in a way that you weren't expecting. But if you allow God to have God's way in your life, you'll receive it as being ministered to.
Is Jesus. I am so excited that we are taking this time to do.
are more important